Hi everyone, welcome to the Human Anatomy Lectures. We are going to start nervous system with this lecture. Since there is much to be covered in nervous system, I have divided it into three topics, topics 7, 8 and 9. And each topic has two lectures. So there are a total of six lectures for nervous system. The main organs or components of the nervous system are the brain, spinal cord, nerves and the sense organs. There are three main functions of the nervous system. The first one is gathering information, and scientifically we call it as the sensory input. So any trigger or change in the external environment is known as a stimulus, plural would be stimuli, and the nervous system receives this stimulus. The second function is integration. After the stimulus has been received, the information is processed and interpreted, and then it is decided if some kind of action is required. The third function is the motor input. The motor input means the response to the processed stimulus. So usually the brain or the spinal cord will send an order and will respond to the stimulus, usually by coordinating the activities of other systems, and the action is taken through the muscles or the glands. So whatever takes the action is known as the effector organ. This slide illustrates the functioning of the nervous system using a flowchart. Let us imagine that you're walking in an outlet mall, and then out of the corner of your eye, you notice that there's a 90% sale in Coach store. So there's a sale on Coach bags. That was the sensory input. Immediately that information is processed in the brain, and even before you realize what is happening, you find that your legs are running and you're running towards the store there. The nervous system can be classified based on the structure into two categories. The first one is the central nervous system, or CNS for short, and the second one is peripheral nervous system, or PNS for short. CNS includes the brain and the spinal cord. So the functions of these organs are, they are mainly the integration or the control centers. They are also the command centers. So they receive the sensory input, the stimulus, they process the information, and they issue the outgoing orders or commands. The PNS, or the peripheral nervous system, includes the nerves coming out from the brain and the spinal cord. So there are two types of nerves: cranial nerves, which are coming out from the brain, and spinal nerves, which are coming out from the spinal cord. Function of PNS is, these are the communication lines. These are the nerves that are carrying information from the sensory organs to the brain or the spinal cord, and finally from the brain or the spinal cord back to the glands or the muscles. So this figure is a summary of the divisions of nervous system. The CNS includes the brain and the spinal cord, while the PNS includes the cranial nerves and the spinal nerves. The peripheral nervous system, or PNS, can be further classified into the sensory and the motor division. The sensory division is also known as the efferent division, while the motor division is also known as the efferent division. So the sensory division includes nerves that carry a signal or information to the central nervous system, that means always in the direction of the CNS. While the motor division includes nerve fibers that carry signals away from the CNS, that means always opposite from the direction of the CNS. For example, when you touch something hot, the electrical signal is transmitted by the sensory division from your skin, or from the tip of your finger, to the CNS. Once the information has been processed by the CNS, a command goes, and this is transmitted by the motor division from the CNS to the effector organs, such as the muscles in your arm, that contracts and make you pull your finger away. The efferent and the efferent divisions can further be classified based on whether their innervation location is voluntary or involuntary. The efferent division is subdivided into the somatic portion that monitors skeletal muscles and other voluntary areas, while the visceral portion monitors smooth muscles, cardiac muscles, or other involuntary areas. The efferent division is subdivided into somatic and autonomic nerves. The somatic nerves control voluntary skeletal muscles. The autonomic nerves control internal organs and other involuntary glands or organs. The autonomic nerves are further divided into sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. This figure shows how a nerve or neurons shown in red are taking an electrical signal from the spinal cord to the large intestine. The parasympathetic and the sympathetic nerves control the same organs but have opposite effects. For example, the parasympathetic nerves cause the constriction of the pupil in the eye, while the sympathetic nerves cause pupil dilation. The parasympathetic nerves decrease heart rate, sympathetic increase the heart rate. Parasympathetic tense the urinary bladder, while sympathetic relax the urinary bladder. This figure is a summary of the organization of nervous system or how the nervous system acts. So imagine that you're walking in Yosemite National Park or in the Big Bear Mountains and you suddenly come face to face with a bear. So that is the stimulus or the input. Immediately your eyes and other sensory division, they conduct action potentials, that means signals or stimuli, from the body to the CNS. So when the message goes to the CNS, the brain and the spinal cord, they process the information, integrate the information, and they would immediately send out some orders. So responses are going from the CNS, it would be traveling towards the body. So the motor division would receive or take the message from the CNS to the body, and it would act both on the somatic and the autonomic components of the system. The somatic nervous system would take a message to your skeletal muscle, the muscles will contract, and the response is that you start running away. While the autonomic nervous system acts on your cardiac muscle, that means your heart starts beating faster to pump more blood, that means to take more oxygen to the muscles. Your smooth muscles will also act. They will stop any other activity that is not required. So if digestion was occurring, then the digestion is paused for a while. And the glands are also influenced. A lot of adrenaline hormone would be secreted. Neural or nervous tissue is composed of two types of cells. First are neurons or nerve cells. These are the cells that are responsible for transmitting all of the electrical information. A neuron consists of the cell body or soma, the axon and dendrites. The second type of cells in neural tissue is known as neuroglia or nerve glue. These include various types of supporting cells, and their main function is to protect and nourish the neuron. The neuroglia includes all types of support cells which are grouped together under this umbrella. These are smaller in size as compared to the neurons because neurons are the longest cells in the body, but they outnumber, they are more in number than the neurons. Their function is to support, insulate and protect the neurons. There are four types of neuroglia in the CNS. The first one is known as astrocytes. This is the most abundant neuroglia and they are star-shaped. They have special extensions which are known as perivascular feet. So the perivascular feet go out and they grab the neurons and the blood vessels. So in doing so, they form physical barriers between the blood capillaries and neurons, and this is how they control the chemical environment of the brain. The figure shows an astrocyte. Notice the food processes or the perivascular feet of the astrocytes. The second type of neuroglia in the CNS are the microglia. The microglia are specialized macrophages, that means they are immune cells. These are soldiers and these are responsible for eating up any dead or damaged neurons and also dispose of debris. They look like small spiders. The third type of neuroglia is known as ependymal cells. These are ciliated cells which line the cavities inside brain and spinal cord. And these cavities contain a special fluid called cerebrospinal fluid. So the cilia or the short hair-like structures in the ependymal cell, they help with the circulation of this fluid. This figure shows the ciliated ependymal cells. The last type of neuroglial cell in the CNS is oligodendrocytes. The oligodendrocytes produce a special type of protective covering called myelin sheath, which wraps around the nerve fibers or the axons. This figure shows all the four types of neuroglial cells in the CNS.